Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The program will begin shortly. Ladies and gentlemen, please silence your electronic devices and take a moment to locate your nearest emergency exit before the program begins. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The program is about to begin.
You are about to enter another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. A journey into a wondrous land of innovation. That's the signpost up ahead. Your next stop, the Corporate Real Estate Zone. The workplace, the final frontier. These are the voyages of CoreNet Global. Its mission, to explore strange new spaces, to seek out new ways of working as enterprise leaders, to boldly go where no end user has gone before. A long time ago, in a workplace far, far away. It is a period of globalization. Corporate real estate professionals, striking from open, collaborative offices everywhere, have won their first victory, adding value to their enterprises. But business continues to move at warp speed. Can corporate real estate executives keep pace? Armed with the profession's ultimate weapon, CoreNet Global, they have enough education and networking power to innovate for light years to come. CoreNet Global Chair Randy Smith is racing to the CoreNet Global Summit to help his colleagues disrupt or be disrupted, to inspire innovation in corporate real estate professionals around the world.
Help us, CoreNet Global. You're our only hope.
Wow, that was quite a ride. I guess I'm all here. Sorry I'm late. I was delayed by CoreNet staff as they were dreaming up inventive ways for the chair to look foolish. They could at least have given me a little more hair. So be it. Good morning, and welcome to the CoreNet Global Summit in Los Angeles 2015. May the CoreNet Global Force be with you. Okay, so I'll never make it as the voice of God from the back of the room. I do know that the CoreNet Force has been with me during most of my 26-year career. So whether you're new to corporate real estate or a seasoned pro, there's always something to learn here at the Global Summit. And that's why we convene as a profession. Whether it's member knowledge sharing or staff-curated content, we've got an innovative program planned for the next 2 days. So let's get ready to disrupt. And get ready for an exciting ride. I'll meet you on the other side. But not the dark side.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Hollywood, and welcome to the CoreNet Global Summit, Disruptive Innovation, the Business of Change. Let's give a round of applause for your hosts, live and in person, CoreNet Global Chair Randy Smith and CEO Angela Kane.
Good morning and welcome. Randy, I've got to say that was quite an entrance you made. Fortunately for you and for all of our audience, I left my Princess Leia costume at the dry cleaner.
Yeah, well, moving right along before you having me wearing a Chewbacca outfit.
We're here in Los Angeles to convene the profession, to disrupt, to innovate, to question the status quo, and to stop saying this is the way we've always done it. We want to promote curiosity, creativity, and imagination in corporate real estate.
That's right, Angela, and it's great to see such a large crowd with us here this morning. We have more than 2,800 attendees at this summit from 23 countries with us over the next few days. And we wouldn't be able to put on such amazing programs such as this one without the generous support of our sponsors. Thanks this morning in particular to BDO, Mars Drinks, Savile Studley, and Unispace for being today's general session sponsors, and Mars Drinks for sponsoring today's keynote speaker.
We'd also like to thank our Global Summit sponsors as follows, and this is a very long list. We thank you so much. Our Diamond sponsors, CBRE, Cushman & Wakefield, JLL, and Steelcase. Our Emerald sponsors, Assure Software, Colliers International, Mars Drinks, and Savile Studley. Our Ruby sponsors, AgileQuest, Arizona Commerce Authority, Avison Young, Colite, Cressa, MCore Facility Services, IBM, Nespresso Business Solutions, Newmark Grubb Knight Frank, Planon, and Regis. Our Sapphire sponsors, ABM, Ascenda Singbridge, Bentley Mills, Brookfield Global Integrated Solutions, Free Access, Herman Miller, iOffice, ISS Facility Services, KI, Lee and Associates, Lincoln Harris, Liquid Space, Greater Memphis Chamber of Commerce, Saraview, Technion, and the Virginia Economic Development Partnership. Let's give them all a round of applause.
Truly an impressive list of sponsors that keep this organization going. But we'd also like to thank our more than 80 corporate partners for their company support and active engagement in our association throughout the year. Thank you.
And we'd like to thank our strategic partners, our gold partners, our silver partners, and our bronze partners. Thank you to all of them.
We've also had record membership growth in recent years, 9,500 members, up from just 6,400 in 2010. And this is really an important point, given that we have not been on a mission to grow. We've been on a mission to strengthen our overall value proposition, and the market's responded as a result. We're proud of the progress we've made in recent years, and we demonstrated that in a progress report that was sent to all of you via email. The document shares progress made on key strategic priorities across a lot of fronts, but some of the key ones are strengthening service and value for corporations engaged in our association. While we recognize that we're still an individual member organization, we know it's equally important to add value to the companies that are supporting their employees' engagement with CoreNet. Building stronger relationships with universities around the world as we work to build the pipeline of talent and raise awareness of the profession. And we're constantly strengthening our learning platform as the corporate real estate role continues to evolve.
In support of these priorities, I'll highlight the following. We're pleased to announce that our Essential Guide to Corporate Real Estate has been published and is now available to be downloaded as an ebook, and you can order the printed version online at cornetglobal.org. Both versions are free to members. This primer in the practice of corporate real estate was developed in partnership with member subject matter experts from around the world, and I'd like to thank them for their meaningful input in this important project. Please join me in thanking them in a round of applause. Our Master of Corporate Real Estate Professional Designation Program is getting a facelift. Randy just appointed a board task force to select subject matter experts to assist with instructional designers in revising six key courses beginning later this fall. This helps ensure that our program remains the gold standard for corporate real estate training and development.
We also have our Leadership Development Certificate Program, and it made its debut last fall and continues to get rave reviews. The coursework really complements our existing professional designation program by adding soft skills training that is customized for corporate real estate professionals.
And finally, one of our most exciting initiatives has been to launch our student competition, where we ask students from around the world at universities to help solve a problem for corporate real estate. I'm so pleased to report that 78 teams from 26 countries registered, and ultimately we had 29 submissions from 11 countries, an amazing response for our first challenge. Three team finalists from three different countries joined us here at the summit to compete in a live presentation yesterday in front of an esteemed panel of member and academic judges. The winning team will be announced at our recognition dinner tomorrow night. They'll win a $10,000 prize and a $10,000 grant for their university to support corporate real estate education. Thanks to Cushman & Wakefield for sponsoring our inaugural challenge. In closing, I would say that there are hundreds of ways to get involved in CoreNet Global and take advantage of the full benefits of your membership. All you have to do is plug in. I look forward to visiting with all of you over the next couple of days. Always, always welcome your ideas, feedback, and suggestions on how we can serve you better.
Speaking of plugging in, there are hundreds of ways to take advantage of this summit experience. I'd like to highlight a few new offerings we have at this event. First, our Wellness Challenge, sponsored by JLL. Attendees can compete for the most steps taken and calories burned over the next 2 days as you walk back and forth from the hotel to here. So use the CoreNet Global app to self-report your activity and win prizes. Winners will be announced at the closing general session tomorrow. Next, our Innovation Spotlight. Located in the Innovation Pavilion, this space on our show floor will allow you to experience drones, robots, and advanced technologies such as the Toyota Mirai hydrogen fuel cell vehicle. You'll also want to stop by the Farmers Insurance Mobile Claims Catastrophe Bus, a high-tech emergency response vehicle located in the back of the hall. For those of us who deal in risk mitigation and business continuity, this is a must-see. Our CoreNet Global Connect booth is located next to registration. We are hosting a tailgate party there this evening in support of our university initiative. And tomorrow, we invite you to meet our global board of directors and chapter leaders on Thursday during lunch. Staff will be there throughout the event to answer any questions you may have. We also have a bookstore in our Innovation Pavilion, so don't forget to stop and buy books from many of our presenters, including Brian Grazier. So pick up a book, and he will be doing a book signing tomorrow afternoon. We also have live streaming of our breakout sessions this year. So look for sessions marked with the symbol noted on the screens in your summit program and the app. You can choose to watch some of the sessions in the breakout room itself or in one of the learning theaters in the Innovation Pavilion. So before we get on with the rest of today's program, please direct your attention to the screens for a sneak preview of tomorrow morning's keynote speaker.
CJ on the beat. Hi, my name's Vin. I'm an entrepreneur, a keynote speaker, and a magician. And I'm going to be your keynote speaker later on in the summit for the CoreNet Global Conference in Los Angeles. Now, before we meet, I can't wait to meet all of you, I'd like to share with you a quick story from Einstein. Now, not many people know this unless you're obsessed about Einstein's life like myself, but in 1942, Einstein taught in Oxford College. And while he taught there, he was teaching a class of physics students in their first year in 1942. And at the end of that year, he gave them all an exam. Of course, having Einstein as your teacher, all of them passed with flying colors. Now, he taught the same class in 1943. And at the end of that year, he decided to do something that blew everybody away in a bad way. He said to all the assistant teachers, "I'm going to give all the students the exact same exam as last year." So all the assistant teachers obviously questioned Einstein. "Einstein, what are you doing? Why are we giving the students the exact same exam? This is crazy. No one's ever done this in Oxford in the history of our university." And obviously Einstein, with his credibility, said, "I'm Einstein, just do it." I'm sure that's what he said. And you see, at this point, the assistant teachers had no choice other than to give the students the exact same exam. But after they handed out the exam, they went to the back of the room and they questioned Einstein like crazy. "Einstein, what are we doing? You have to explain to us what's going on." And Einstein said something truly profound. He said, "All the questions are the same. You're right. All the questions are exactly the same. But the answers have completely changed." You see, when I first read about this story, I thought to myself, this is a beautiful metaphor for business. Because in the world of business, the questions are always the same. How do we reduce costs? How do we add more value to our customers? How do we find customers in a more effective and productive manner? You know, it's always the same set of questions. But what we have to realize is the answers to those questions have completely changed in today's world. So what I want to do in my keynote is I want to give you a whole new perspective. Now, as a magician, I'll be using magic as my metaphor. So let me show you an example of what I mean. If I get all of you to look at this card very carefully, and as you watch this card without taking your eyes off it, watch what happens. You see, the card completely changes. And from your point of view, you're thinking to yourself, oh my goodness, how did he do this? It's crazy. You see, but if I had to define what magic is, because I'm sure you're wondering, what is magic? Then could you share with us the meaning of magic? Magic is just a problem that you can't solve. So you see, the reason you can't solve this problem right now is because you're looking at it from one perspective. But if I showed you a perspective from down under, I think you'll find it quite intriguing. You see, with this different perspective, all of a sudden, a problem that you could not solve before, now you can solve. So you see, that's what I want to do in my keynote session. I want to give you a completely different perspective on business and show you some new things and new ways of thinking that you can apply to what you do right away. Looking forward to seeing all of you very soon.
You won't want to miss that, so thank you. And now, please welcome Michael Casolo, President, Enterprise Client Solutions, Global Occupier Services for Cushman & Wakefield, our summit polling sponsor.
Good morning, everyone. The new Cushman & Wakefield is proud to be closely aligned with CoreNet Global in many areas of thought leadership and industry innovation. Together with all of you, we're considering ways to create positive disruptions in the industry with programs like the New Academic Challenge, which brought students from around the globe into the conversation about real estate, up to this year's topic for the CoreNet Cushman & Wakefield poll, the Talent Agenda. We had great participation in the Talent Agenda poll at last month's European Summit in London, and we hope to have equally strong participation here in Los Angeles this week. Please take a few minutes to give us your perspective on how real estate can influence success in recruiting and retaining talent in our industry. To take the poll, click on the Let's Talk Talent banner on the CoreNet Summit app, or come by the Cushman & Wakefield polling station in the Innovation Pavilion. At the end of the survey, you can register to win an Apple Watch, for those that don't already have one, and we look forward to hearing from you. We look forward to reporting back the collective responses later this week, right here at the summit. Thank you very much.
In keeping with our theme of disruption, we were a little disrupted last night. Unfortunately, our keynote speaker got stuck in New York due to mechanical difficulty on his flight. The good news is that we always aim to innovate, and we have an exciting speaker with us instead. For those of you who went to Randy's chairman dinner Saturday night, you got to hear from an astronaut, Dr. Garrett Reisman. He has graciously agreed to step in as if he already wasn't an American hero. He's a rocket scientist, and in my book, he's a rock star.
Indeed. So here to properly introduce our keynote speaker, please welcome Xavier Unkovic, Global President for Mars Drinks.
Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. Hope you're doing all very well. And to have Garrett as a keynote speaker today is quite special for me because this is the first time someone from Mars is going to introduce somebody that has been very humbling. So welcome all. I'm Xavier Unkovic. I'm the global president of Mars Drinks. And Mars Drinks is a business that belongs to Mars Incorporated. And of course, Mars Incorporated do great products. You probably all know our beautiful chocolate that has been in the shuttle, by the way. So make sure you ask Garrett the story of the M&Ms in the shuttle. This is quite stunning, yeah. We do chocolate, we do gum, we make food products, and we also make drinks products. And at Mars Drinks, yeah, We're very proud of what we do. We make high quality products, great tasting products, but we do more than that. Yeah, our division, Mars Drinks, is 100% focused on the workplace, servicing the workplace. And we say that we create great tasting moments at work. We truly believe that our products and our technologies help create moments of collaboration, engagement, well-being, and productivity at the workplace. And because of this dedication to serving the workplace, we're delighted to be the keynote sponsor for this year's CoreNet Global Summit. Both Mars Drinks and CoreNet focus our energies, creating value in the place where we all spend nearly 90% of our time at work. And we're very pleased to participate into the conversation of this conference, with the theme of disrupting innovation and the business of change. And I would like also to invite you all to our booth to enjoy a great drink, coffee, drink, tea, hot chocolate, authentic espresso, but also cappuccino and latte. So welcome at our booth all day. But now it's my privilege to welcome our keynote speaker today and to introduce you to a NASA veteran who flew, yes, all three space shuttles, Discovery, Endeavour, and Atlantis. Quite impressive. He spent 95 days aboard the International Space Station. Get ready for an out-of-the-world presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Garrett Reisman.
Thanks, David. Appreciate it. Hi, everybody. Thank you. You know, just one thing before I get started, which is I've been watching the proceedings so far, and I see this Star Trek and Star Wars and Mars, you know, and I'm thinking just one key question, which is, how is I not supposed to be the keynote speaker? I mean, really? Like, some NYU professor is going to follow that? I don't get it. Well, like Xavier said, I did spend 95 days on my first mission aboard the International Space Station. And for those of you that were with us on Saturday, you know that actually I could tell you it was a bit of a disappointment. And who was with us on Saturday? Could somebody yell out why it was a disappointment? 100 days. Yes. If you stay on the space station for 100 days, you get a patch. I was only up for 95. And then the Space Shuttle Discovery came up, and they said, Garrett, time to go home. And I said, fellas, I just need 5 more days. And they said, no, we have to go. Mission Control says we have to land. So I didn't get my patch. And then they said, NASA said, hey, Garrett, we got another mission for you. This time on Atlantis, you'll go up for 14 days. I said, 95 plus 14, get my patch. Sign me up, I'm going, right? And so I did. I went up and I flew again. I got to do another mission, got to do some more spacewalks. It was fantastic. I come back home, I'm ready for my patch. And they said, no, got to be in a row. So I still don't have my patch. You know, if I did, it would go right here, this big empty hole. But I'm not bitter or anything, you know. But it was a fantastic time. Those 95 days up in space were fantastic. What I did was I tried to shrink them down to the highlights in about 5 minutes. So what I want to do is just show you kind of my home movies, 5 minutes of 95 days in space. If we can roll the film, please.
can we prove to people that you're in space right now? Would you please take off your wrist-strong bracelet and spin it in that astronaut way? Now, sir, I can die and go to heaven now.
Thank you. Did you all see the M&Ms? A little shout out to the sponsors there. Okay, that's good. So one of the things that I want to talk to you about today is the importance of setting a really challenging goal for yourself and then doggedly pursuing that goal if it's something that is really important to you. The importance of challenging yourself and then really going after it. And so I want to talk to you a little bit about what has worked for me as far as inspiration and determination. People ask me a lot, well, did you always want to be an astronaut? And the answer is I always thought it was really cool. When I was a little kid, I used to watch films of the Apollo flights. And yeah, if you told me the space shuttle is leaving tomorrow, pack your bags and come with us, I would have been there in a second. But my mom was scared of flying. And the idea of me becoming a test pilot or something was just not going to happen. So I never thought of it as something that could come true. But when I got to college, at the end of my years as an undergrad, I got a hold, and I'm going to date myself, I got a hold of a magazine. Things that are made out of paper is how people used to get news. And inside this magazine, there were bios of some of the current NASA astronauts. And I realized that what they had done, as far as their education, as far as their work experience, was not altogether different from what I was planning to do. And a light bulb went off and said, hey, maybe this is within the realm of possibility. And I went down to the bookstore at the University of Pennsylvania, and I bought this poster. This is the Moonrise, the shot taken on Apollo 8. I'm sorry, the Earthrise, the Earth coming over the moon. And I bought that, and I stuck that up in front of my desk. And whenever I was having a difficult time, having a difficult homework problem or exam weeks coming up or something like that, I would have this beacon up there to inspire me. I had this goal, which was getting to space. And that made me better. It really made me, in everything I did, it made me better at what I was doing. And I said, you know, one day I'm going to hang that poster up in the astronaut office in Houston, Texas. And one day I did. And it's still with me. That poster is now above my desk at SpaceX. I should have mentioned that about 4 years ago I left NASA, and I work now here in California, down in Hawthorne, for a company called SpaceX, where we're building the next generation rockets and spacecraft. And I'm our director of crew operations there. And that is a shot of the backside of my cubicle, where the poster still hangs. So set that goal really high. People also ask me a lot, well, what was it like to launch on the space shuttle? And if you've ever been in a motion simulator or a roller coaster ride even, it's not altogether different than that. As far as the noise and the vibration, you know something exciting is happening. and I guess another way to put it is the pilot on my last mission used to describe it as, well, it's kind of like you're sitting on top of a rocket. Hard to argue with the veracity of that statement, but not very helpful. So it does shake. It does make a lot of noise. You've got millions of pounds of thrust. And when those solid rockets light up, boy, you're definitely going someplace in a hurry. But it's not crazy. It's not so super loud or it shakes so super much that it's unlike anything you've experienced before. But what is different are the G-forces. So the engines create this acceleration, which creates this force that pushes you back into your seat, and you feel heavy. It's that G-force. And the shuttle can pull up to 3 Gs, meaning that you feel like you weigh about 3 times as much as you really do. Now, 3 Gs is not a lot. When we train in our aerobatic aircraft, we could pull 7, 8 Gs, no problem. But the thing is, when you do that in an airplane, you do it for a few seconds. If you're doing a loop, you pull back on the stick to start that loop, and you feel those 6, 7 Gs, but almost immediately you start letting off the G, and it just lasts for a few seconds, and you're over the top of the loop. The difference about the shuttle is it goes on and on. It goes on for minutes. So a minute goes by, and your brain is doing the integration. It knows that that's acceleration, and so after about a minute, you think to yourself, I'm going pretty fast. And then another minute goes by, and you think to yourself, okay, I'm going really fast. And then another minute goes by, and you say, I'm going super ridiculously fast. Get me out of here. But, you know, it's too late. You're strapped in, and there's no turning back. So, yeah, you go from 0 miles an hour to 17,500 miles an hour in 8.5 minutes. So there's no other acceleration like that. And then at the end of that 8.5 minutes, the engines shut down instantaneously, and you go from 3 Gs to zero. And it feels like you're getting shot out of your seat. And you put your arms up like this because you're afraid you're going to become a bug on the windscreen, like you're going to get smashed against the bulkhead. But you immediately feel pretty silly because you're no longer, it's not that you're being shot out of your seat, you're just no longer being held into your seat, right? Everything is floating around, and all the veteran astronauts are pointing at you and laughing. Look at the new guy with the hands up, yeah. And you're like, yeah, I knew that was going to happen. Yeah. And then you're in space. People want to know also, what was it like the first time I looked out and I saw the planet Earth from space? Well, it was about a half an hour after we got up to space because I'm downstairs in the space shuttle. There's only one tiny window. And I'm busy. There's lots of work to do as soon as you get up to space. And so 30 minutes went by before I noticed out of the corner of my eye this pale blue glow, and it was coming from that little window. And I said, oh, that's the planet Earth. I should probably go have a look at that. And I expected kind of a religious experience. Something transcendental was about to happen to me. So I paused, and I relaxed, and I collected myself, and then I slowly floated up, opened my eyes, and they gazed out upon the wonder of the planet Earth from space. Meh. It's all right. You know, lots of nice Earth colors, blues and browns and greens. It kind of looked like that, right? Like that picture you see. We've all seen pictures of the Earth from space now. It's not like Yuri Gagarin who had no idea what he was going to see, right? So it wasn't that surprising. It was nice. You know, it was nice. But I didn't like feel, I didn't hear like a heavenly choir. I didn't grab my crewmates' hands and sing Kumbaya and like pray for peace on earth and whatnot. It was nice. So that was not too impressive. But what was left a much deeper impression was not looking down at the earth, but rather looking at the horizon. So if you look at this photo, if you see that where the blackness of space meets the earth, you see there's a very thin blue line. That's the atmosphere. Look how skinny that is. When you see that, it's really shocking. You look at that, and it looks so fragile. It looks like a gust of wind could just come by and strip it all away. I mean, that's all, it's amazing. That's all space out there, right? It's a vacuum. Why doesn't it just suck it all away? But it sticks around, thank goodness, right? And then I had another thought. About a week later, I was looking down at the ocean. And now here's a pop quiz. Which is thicker, the height of the atmosphere or the depth of the ocean? How many people think it's the height of the atmosphere? Couple, okay. How many people, this will be graded. How many people think it's the depth of the ocean? Okay, the first guys were right. It's the height of the, congratulations. there'll be applications in the back for our next mission. it's a trick question, though, because the atmosphere is kind of a continuum. It's hard to say exactly where it ends. But we draw a line at 100 kilometers or about 300 and so thousand feet. That's where the atmosphere kind of fades out and becomes just a collection of atoms. The depth of the ocean, not the mean depth, but the deepest part of the ocean is the Marianas Trench, and that's about 35,000 feet deep. So the atmosphere is about 10 times thicker than the ocean is deep. And now look again at how thin that thing is. And think about all the things that matter to you and me, our families, our all the animals, all the plants, the water, the rainbows, the mountains, all the things that you think of when you think of Earth, the whales, flowers, all that stuff, right? That's all in that tiny little strip between the bottom of the ocean and the top of the atmosphere. And if you think about the Earth that way, I mean, yeah, it's huge. When you look out the window of the space shuttle, it takes up the whole window. It's this massive planet. But it's really, the important part is just this little tiny surface coating on what is otherwise a big dead rock. So if you think about the Earth that way, and if you think about the dimensions, it's really about the same as the skin on an apple or the shell on an egg. So when you think about the Earth that way, it doesn't seem so big. When I'm back down here now and I look out at the sky or the sea, it doesn't seem vast and limitless, and it definitely looks like something that we can mess up. And that left a big impression. Talking again about inspiration and determination, one of the coolest things you can do as an astronaut is a spacewalk. It's awesome. It's really, really cool. And it's something I knew from the very beginning that I would love to have a chance to do. When you go down to interview to become an astronaut, they encourage you to walk around the offices and talk to current astronauts and find out, you know, what you're getting into, right? And so I went and I talked to this one astronaut, and I said, hey, I've been living out in California. I've been doing this rock climbing. I was a wrestler, and, you know, I thought maybe some of these skills might be transferable, and maybe I could do a spacewalk. And this astronaut laughed in my face. He said, what are you, like 5 foot what? He said, you're too short to do a spacewalk. Are you kidding me? Look at you. You're tiny. It's a very mean astronaut. Astronauts are supposed to be nice. You're supposed to be nice. You know, we all the time, we tell kids, you know, follow your dreams. He's squashing mine. But he did. He's like, it's not going to work. The suit is one size fits all. You know, you're going to get swallowed up in there. You're going to be trying to do your work, and you don't have. They thought the conventional wisdom was that you have to be like an orangutan, you know, have these incredibly long arms to be able to do anything in that suit. And it's true. It is hard to do stuff in that suit. But again, this was something that meant a lot to me, and so I was undeterred. And when I got selected to be an astronaut, I went down to the pool where we train, and I tried. And it turns out that, yes, if you do things exactly the same way as everybody else, it's difficult to do a spacewalk if you're only 5 foot something. But if you think differently and you innovate and you use your tools differently and you position your body differently than everybody else, turns out you can do it. And in fact, in certain cases, it's an advantage. You can reach into deep, into like little nooks and crannies better than the big guys. And the bottom line was, I ended up doing 3 spacewalks, including this one right here, over the course of my career. And that mean astronaut that laughed in my face, he never got to do a single one. Thanks. But it is fantastic. And on this one, this was on my second mission, and that's me on the end of the robot arm for the space station, holding onto this huge antenna that we were installing on top of the space station. And if my crewmates were here, they would tell you, actually, it's not that big of an antenna. It's just little astronaut. And but I'm telling you, that's a huge antenna. Really big. And the other great thing about doing this task was we all knew that the shuttle program was coming to an end. We only had a couple more flights after this one. And so we were all thinking about fallback options. And I figured, well, if I can't fly shuttles anymore, I can always like get a job with DirecTV. I was actually putting this antenna up on the roof of my house one day, and my wife came out and said, hey, that looks familiar. I said, wait, let me go get the camera. Yeah. So back to that spacewalk. This is on top of that robot arm, and at this point, that robot arm is about 60 feet long. And at one point, it swung me up, and it was sticking straight up from the space station. And so I was about 6 stories up looking down, and I took this selfie. This is a selfie. If you look really careful, down in the bottom right, you can see me holding the camera, and I'm taking a picture of my own helmet. And the visor is acting like a mirror, and you can see everything I was looking at the time. So if you look really carefully, you can see almost the whole space station down there. You can see the space shuttle Atlantis peeking her nose over the top there on the right. And of course, the Earth. And every bit of commercial real estate in the entire planet is in this photo. And if you look really carefully, in the center and a little bit to the left, you see another astronaut in his spacesuit way, way, way down there. That gives you some idea of how far away I was. And that was my nearest source of help should anything go wrong. So that was kind of disconcerting. But it was a remarkable and wonderful opportunity to have this chance to take a picture of literally everybody else, alive or dead, was down there. One of the most fun things to do other than the spacewalk, because you can't do a spacewalk every day, unfortunately, is the floating. And when I say floating, what I really mean is the flying, because as soon as you push your away from the wall, you go shooting across the space station as if you're Superman. So if you've ever had a dream where you just kind of close your eyes and dream that if you put your arms out and you get a good running start, you just start flying, it's like that every day. I mean, that was my commute. I would wake up in the morning, and like, okay, time to go get some breakfast. Dun, da, da, dun, shoo. Up, up, and away. And that never got old. On day 95, that was just as much fun as it was on day 1. That was really outstanding. Another fun thing to do was take pictures of places on the Earth that meant something to me. For example, this one. Does anybody know where that is? Yeah, that's us right now. You are here in the upper right there. That's downtown LA. You can see Dodger Stadium and the Staples Center is up in the upper right there. So we take these photos, and I've taken pictures of the Eiffel Tower and the pyramids and stuff like that, and I show them to people, and people think you can see these things. You can't, okay? This photograph was taken with an 800-millimeter lens. It's like a telescope. If you look at this photo, who knows where this is? That's also Los Angeles. So it's also a picture of the Staples Center. But this was taken with a 55-millimeter lens, which means it's basically a 1-to-1 magnification. So this is what it looks like with the naked eye when you go up to the window and look down at the Earth. So you can't see Dodger Stadium. You can't see individual buildings. You can see there's something unnatural because LA has got this kind of gray, grid-like texture. but you can't see individual buildings. So the last space shuttle landed quite a long time ago. It's over 4 years now. And a lot of people think that NASA's kind of given up or gone out of business. And I want to tell you that nothing is further from the truth. NASA's working really hard. The reason the space shuttles aren't flying anymore was they were very expensive. They were wonderful flying machines, the most sophisticated flying machine ever devised. But they were costing us $4 billion a year to operate, roughly $1 billion every time we launched one. So we weren't going to get enough money out of Congress to keep doing that and build something else. So we decided we're going to stop flying the shuttles and we're going to start working on something new. And what I'd like to tell you a little bit about is exactly what we're doing. What's next? Well, NASA's done is pursuing two paths. One is a traditional government approach where they're building a very, very big rocket, and it's called the SLS. Not a very catchy name. But the big rocket, and they're building a capsule called the Orion that's going to be capable of going out from low Earth orbit. So they're working on that. At the same time, they're turning to the private sector and seeing if they can turn loose some of the innovation and disrupt the space industry, if you will. So I saw something amazing happen right at the end of my time at NASA, right after my last mission. I saw this company, SpaceX, located right down the road, create this rocket, the Falcon 9 rocket, and the Dragon spacecraft, the capsule at the top. And back in 2010, they put it into space. It did two orbits around the Earth and came back down, and they recovered it, becoming the first private company to send something to space and bring it back. And I thought, wow, that's something really amazing. And it's even more amazing because not just that a private company can do this, but because they did it so efficiently. That rocket and the spacecraft and the whole program cost NASA a total of about $200 million of taxpayer money. Now, I would love to have $200 million of anybody's money. But that's not a lot when it comes to the space business. NASA and the Air Force have a parametric cost estimation tool that they use to figure out how much it should cost to build a new rocket. And when they put the parameters into that model and they spit out a price tag, it came out in multiple billions of dollars. And in fact, even after they made adjustments for operating in a more commercial manner, they still come up with $1.2 billion. Well, it didn't cost $1.2 billion, it cost $0.2. And I said, wow, there's a chance here. If we can really make space more accessible, there's a chance here that we can really have a whole paradigm shift in space. And so I left NASA and I signed up with this company. My boss is Elon Musk. He created PayPal, SpaceX, and he also created and is the CEO of Tesla and SolarCity as well. So he's a pretty impressive guy, and he knows how to innovate and disrupt. And he says the same thing I've been telling you, which is the quote right there, which is that if there's something that's important to you, if somebody tells you it's impossible to accomplish that thing, don't listen to them. In fact, take it as motivation. When somebody says, you can never do that, that's impossible, you're never going to do a spacewalk, you're never going to go create a company that can privatize space travel. If it is really important to you, just go do it, right? Prove them wrong. Use that as fuel for your energy. So I want to show you just another quick video to give you a couple minutes of an overview of what's happening today at SpaceX. And I think you'll see evident in the video all the innovation that's coming out of this company.
DC confirms flight computers in startup.
Second stage pressing.
Tanks are at flight pressure.
F9 switching to internal power.
T-minus 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Liftoff of the Falcon 9.
Look at the Dragon capsule making its way towards the International Space Station.
The station on two, we see Dragon at 20 meters.
And capture is confirmed.
4, 3, 2, 1, launch.
Thank you. And yes, that was a rocket landing on a boat, which is awesome. It actually didn't quite make it. We cut the video right at time. It touched down. It was kind of leaning over. It just couldn't quite stick the landing. But we're going to try it again very soon, and we're very optimistic. We know what happened wrong. We're going to fix that. So the company does incredibly innovative things. And we have launched our capsule now up to the space station 7 times and dropped off cargo. And what we're doing now, what my job is getting that spacecraft ready to carry people, to get the United States back in the business of launching people into space. So how do we do all this innovation? One is, like I said before, having a vision that's clear and is not, that is incredibly audacious. So JFK understood that. He said, I'm going to challenge you to go to the moon in 10 years. That's crazy at the time. We had barely put anybody into space at all. But he laid that out there, and guess what? We rose to the challenge, and we did it. Elon's trying to do the same thing. His thing is Mars. He wants us to go and colonize Mars, not just plant some flags and leave some footprints, but to leave a human sustainable presence up on the red planet. That's a hugely ambitious goal. But if you ask anybody in our company, why are we doing what we're doing, they'll say it's because we want to make human life multiplanetary. Everybody gets it. And it's unbelievably powerful and motivating people. How do we do innovation? What we do is we bring in what I call disruptors into the workforce, and then we empower them. Disruptors come from a couple different places. One place to get them are our universities. If you take people straight out of undergraduate, before they go out into the workplace, they don't know what's impossible. They don't know what's been done before. So they just go ahead and do new things, and they go ahead and do the impossible. It's fantastic. And if you get the best and the brightest, and you just turn them loose without trying to corral them into a framework that's been passed down from generation to generation, it's remarkable what they can do. The other thing we do is we look to other industries. We go out and we find the cutting edge in whatever we're trying to do, not necessarily grabbing from inside our own ranks to fill positions. There are actually very few of us at SpaceX that came from NASA, very few that came from Lockheed or Boeing. When we wanted, for example, to set up our assembly line, we didn't go and get somebody who was a VP for manufacturing at a rocket company. Because guess what? The aerospace industry, not the world's leaders in efficient manufacturing. But you know who is? Automotive. Automotive is really good at that. So when we wanted to get a VP of manufacturing, we got that guy on the left. That's Andy Lambert. He was the one who set up the assembly line for Mini Cooper for BMW. And he came into SpaceX and said, you're making how many units a year? 4 right now? I used to make 4 units a minute. And I said, yeah, but they're Mini Coopers. They're really small. He's got us now up to 40. The other fellow on the right is our VP of software. And he didn't write code for a satellite or for the space shuttle. He came, we got him from Google. And because if you look out there and find out where the most innovative software is happening, where they're really pushing the envelope, it's not in aerospace anymore. Back in the Apollo days, it was. But now it's not. It's in search and gaming. And our software ranks are filled with people who came from those fields. So if you bring those people in from outside your normal experience base And then you create an environment where the worst thing you can say in a meeting is, we should do it this way because that's the way we've always done it. If you make that completely unacceptable and you empower these disruptors, then you could land rockets on boats. It's unbelievable what you can do. So I just want to leave you with the thought. I hope this was helpful to you. I hope you can have a few takeaways. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. But we're kind of in a painful moment right now in the space business. Since this is a picture of Atlantis, the last space shuttle landing just over 4 years ago. And since that time, we no longer are able to get American men and women into space on our own. We have to ask our good friends, the Russians, to help us out and take our astronauts up and back to the space station. And that's not a good place for this nation to be. This nation has always led the way in space, and we need to continue to lead the way. And although it looks from the outside that we might have given up that mantle of leadership, I'm here to tell you that no, we have not. That in just a couple more years, we're going to have a blossoming, a golden age in spaceflight. Because it's not just SpaceX. There's also other companies working on space planes and working on their own capsules. And there's a whole bunch of work going on behind the scenes. It's just they're still in the design and development phase. When all these bright, shiny toys come rolling out the end of the factories and you start seeing them flying, you're going to realize that the U.S. is back better than ever. And we're going to have Americans launching on American rockets from American soil in just about 2 more years. So stay tuned. We've got a really, really bright future in space. Thanks. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Now, I think we have a bunch of microphones set up, and I'd be happy to answer any questions I haven't touched upon, any topics you'd like me to address, either about being in space or SpaceX or anything you'd like to hear. So just come up. Don't be shy. Come up to the microphones, and I'll be happy to take your questions. Number two, yes.
Thank you very much for your fascinating talk. I just really enjoyed that. For the planned Mars missions, are there plans to have some type of centrifugal gravity for the long duration that these flights are going to take?
That's a good question. You guys all see The Martian? You see that bit of the space ship that was spinning around so they can walk? I think that was mostly done because the special effects to make everybody float all the time are really expensive. But having some kind of artificial gravity, like you suggest, mostly by spinning a section of a space station or spinning the whole ship, is one way to go. But what we're finding on the space station is we can combat some of the effects of weightlessness that are not so good for you, like losing some of your bone, losing some of your muscle. I was up there for 3 months. I lost 3% of my bone density. It's okay. It all came back. I did a bunch of, thanks. I appreciate the concern. That was nice. I did a bunch of rehab and physical therapy, came back. It feels fine. The weird thing is it didn't all go back exactly where it came from. So I have a slightly rearranged skeleton. So there are serious problems medically with the absence of gravity. But we think actually one of the best ways we can fight that is through resistive exercise. So we do a lot of weightlifting up in space, which is ironic because nothing weighs anything. But we do that, and I think that or for really long term, we might have to go with some kind of artificial gravity, but the jury's still out. Number three, yes.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for your speech. Very innovation and inspire for thanks. all around here. I am checking in internet and maybe have a project for NASA about the space elevator that is construction for the outside of the, you know, the distance to the air, to the space is too short, no, it's too big, no, compared with the universe.
Yeah, so some people propose these space elevators, and if we can get it to work, it'd be fantastic, because the idea is that we have, at a certain altitude, The speed, I said 17,500 miles an hour. That's how fast you have to go when you're in low Earth orbit, where the space shuttle and the space station were. And That means you go around the Earth every hour and a half. Every 90 minutes you go around. So every 45 minutes the sun is either rising or setting, which is pretty amazing. Now, the further out you go, the slower it gets, your speed. And if you get out to about 22,000 miles, I think it is, the speed at which you go around the Earth is exactly the same as the Earth's rotation. And that's called geostationary orbit. Arthur C. Clarke, actually, the author, was the first one to come up with this realization that this was possible. And this is where most of our communication satellites exist, because they sit right over the United States and beam television signals and high-speed internet and all that good stuff down to us. So if you can now take that satellite up there and run a very strong cable down to the ground, it would just stay there and keep moving with the Earth. And then you could ride an elevator back and forth. You wouldn't need these really expensive rockets anymore, right? So it's great. The problem is the engineering challenges with creating such a system are immense. We did some experiments on the space shuttle with tethers that we extended a long way down, and they build up static charge. They build up all kinds of electrical charge. The forces involved, you have to have an unbelievably strong tether for this to work. So it has, on paper, it has a lot of promise, but in practice, I think it's going to be really hard to pull off. Next. Over there, number five.
Okay, so the movie Gravity. Can you speak a little bit about what it's like to be in space and deal with all the debris that's currently orbiting the Earth?
That's a good question. Especially when that movie first came out, I was getting that question all the time. People wanted to know how realistic it was. And I tell them it was incredibly realistic. I mean, just look at that Clooney guy. He looks just like me, right? It's obvious. There were a bunch of actual violations of the laws of physics in that movie, which I'm not one of those guys that lets the truth get in the way of a good story, so that was fine with me. But my wife pointed out probably the biggest fallacy, which was, if you've got a hold of George Clooney, why would any woman in there let him go? Didn't make sense. So, but as far as the debris goes, the debris is real. And it's a big problem. We've got little pieces of junk all over space right now, especially in the low Earth orbit area where this shuttle and the space station are. But it's a huge problem, because it eventually will all come back down, but it can persist a long, long time, especially if it's small and light. But it's moving so fast, it's really dangerous. The orbital speed, I keep quoting, 17,000 miles an hour, is about 10 times faster than a rifle bullet. So anything, even the smallest amount of mass moving at that speed, because the energy is the square of the velocity, is going to do tremendous damage if it hits you. And the space station has a bunch of shielding to protect it. But a couple times, I was inside the space station during my time up there, and I heard the ping of something hitting us. Fortunately, I heard the ping, not followed by the psh, right? That's what you really worry about. But we did take a lot of hits. And then once, when I was out doing that first spacewalk that you saw in the first movie, we had to bring in a handle. That handle was about a half an inch thick of solid aluminum. And when we got it inside, my spacewalk partner, Rick, looked at it, and it had a hole shot straight through, about a millimeter in diameter. And he looked down and he said, man, if that hit one of us. And he didn't have to finish that statement, because it would have been catastrophic. But I did point out that since he's over 6 foot tall, it's probabilistically much more likely to take him out. So it's a big problem. The best way we can take care of that problem is to not create any more junk. It's very hard to clean up what's already there. People are proposing things with lasers or giant nets and things to try to clean it up, but that's really hard. The best thing we can do is not make any more of it. And what we're doing is we're being smarter about how we design our rockets, so we don't just let them, like these second stages of the rockets that end up in orbit, we don't allow them to just explode. We intentionally burn the engines again once their job is done and bring it down as one big piece before it comes apart. So that's one of the things we're doing, but we're doing lots of things to try to not make any more junk. Let's see, we've got time for a couple more. Number one, yes.
What kind of leader is Elon, and how do you like working for him?
I want to continue working for him. He's an amazing guy. He's an amazing guy. He's incredibly smart. and technically unbelievably gifted. The amazing thing is the breadth of his knowledge. We can go into him one day with a problem in software, and he'll be practically demanding to rewrite the code himself. In fact, he has on occasion rewritten the code himself. And on the other hand, we can go in there with a strength of materials issue, and we'll be debating the strengths of different alloys, and he'll be completely knowledgeable about that as well. So he's an incredibly intelligent guy. He's very demanding. He does set that really high goal, and he expects you to do everything in your power to get there. And he prides himself more on his technical acumen, really, than his business acumen, which is, his business acumen is incredible if you look at his track record. But what really drives him is his desire to have a lasting impact on the way we all live with the products and technology that he's creating. And probably the best anecdote I can give you to explain that is, early on, I got interviewed with him for 60 minutes when I first joined the company about what we were trying to do. And they asked me the same question. And they asked me, why did I leave NASA? And I said, well, if you had the opportunity back in the days of Howard Hughes to go work for this man that was transforming how, you know, the airline industry, and as a young engineer, wouldn't you want to be part of that? And then a little while, almost immediately as those words came out of my mouth to Scott Pelley, I realized that maybe I've just made a horrible mistake, right? Because I just compared my boss to Howard Hughes, and it didn't end so well for Howard, you know? I got a little creepy at the end. So so it took literally about a year until I had an opportunity, and Elon and I were driving a rental car in Florida, and just the two of us, and I said, hey, boss, you know, that time on TV when I said you're kind of like Howard Hughes, I want you to know I was talking about the dashing, starlit dating young Howard Hughes, not the creepy old guy not cutting the toenails Howard Hughes. Hope you're okay with that. And this is where you get an insight into Elon's character, because he stopped. He didn't just answer immediately. He always carefully considers when he's asked a question. And he deliberated in his head for a little while, and it was kind of an awkward silence. And he said, no, I don't think it's a very apt analogy. I said, okay, well, what is it about the analogy that you don't like? He said, well, none of Howard's designs really had a lasting impact on our society. We don't fly material across the Atlantic in gigantic wooden planes today. Right, that doesn't happen. So he was a brilliant mind, but he didn't have that impact on the world like Elon hopes to. And that's where he went. Right, he went to that, whether or not his designs were truly disruptive and revolutionary, not whether or not he was pissing in jars at the end of his life. He didn't care about that at all. I think I got time for one or two more. Number four.
Hi, thanks for a really inspiring talk. One of the things you've described here in some of these questions, and also in your description of your visit to space, are just how delicate people are in space and the challenges that are associated with keeping people safe in space. Maybe you could comment a little bit on the people in space versus robots in space debate. And it's perhaps a little cheaper to put robots up there than it is people. And I understand the inspiration, but I'd like to hear your take on that debate.
Once I was in a panel discussion in New York with some folks that make robotic spacecraft, and they were going on and on about how much, you know, you don't need a life support system, so you don't need the mass, and look at how great the Spirit and Opportunity rovers are doing, blah, 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 about all those rovers. And they went first, they talked all about, you know, what they thought, and then they turned to me, and I just, all I had to say was, robots are lame. You want to go, right? So really, it all depends on the objective. If your objective is to go to a rock on Mars and take a few chemical readings and get that data back to Earth, then yes, send a rover, for crying out loud. Absolutely, it's going to be way more cost effective. But if your goal is to make life multiplanetary, the idea being that right now all of our eggs are in this one basket, and there's been many extinction events over the course of the Earth's history. Now, you have to think really big on very long timescales. I'm not saying that the sky is falling and, you know, an asteroid is going to hit us tomorrow and wipe us out like the dinosaurs or anything like that. But ultimately, we need to get off this planet if we're going to survive long, long term. If you really think about survival, what that means. To do that, having a bunch of rovers, you know, a bunch of robots on some other planet is not going to accomplish the goal of preserving the human race. So it depends on what you're going there for. The other thing is the complexity of the task. The robots will get, and the automation, it continues to get better and better. But when you look at what some of the Mars rovers have been able to accomplish, I've been sitting right next to a trained geologist watching the rovers operate on the planet. And because of how long it takes just to move a couple, you know, a few tens of yards, it takes a long time to plan all that. And then they get there, and they can only take the readings that the rover was programmed to do. And this geologist sitting right next to me was tearing out his hair, saying, man, if only you could pick up that rock. I want to see what's underneath. But it wasn't programmed to do that. But if you had a human there that could pick up the rock, you might have found the fossil, the key piece of evidence. So it depends on the complexity of the task that you want to do, and it really depends on the purpose of why you're going. OK, I got time for one last question. Let's see. There? Number four? Okay.
So you in your photographs, you show pictures of yourself on a 60-foot boom. You talked about being on the end of a rocket, and obviously you have gone through training that's developed you to that point. But surely in those moments, there must be some level of anxiety. So, and I think we all are in anxious moments, whatever that might be. How do you manage those terrifying, anxious moments?
So we had another question over here at mic number one. yeah, there are definitely times when it gets scary. You're aware, you know, logically, intellectually, you're aware of the risk. I mean, on the space shuttle, you basically had a 1 in 68 chance of fatality on any given mission. If you look at the fact we had 135 missions and we lost 2 space shuttles. So 1 in 68, that's not very good. My mom, as I said, is scared of flying commercial airliners. That's literally, on any given flight, 1 in 5.6 million are your odds of having a fatality. So it's quite a big difference. In fact, 1 in 68 is pretty close to the same odds that an infantryman had when they stormed the beaches at D-Day. So now if you think back to that my 2 launches, it's like I stormed the beaches at D-Day twice, which you had to be crazy. If you were being logical about it. But the truth is that when you're strapped into the rocket and getting ready to blast off, you're not thinking about these things. What you're thinking about is, oh, please, don't let me mess this up. Because you've been training for years, your crewmates and all the people on the ground are depending on you, and you know that whatever's going to happen during this mission is going to, you're going to reflect upon it for a long time. This is a culmination of a lot of effort, and you want to do your job, and you want to do it well. So you're much more scared about not doing a good job than you are about the rocket blowing up. Even when you're feeling those 3 Gs and it's shaking and all that, that's still what you're thinking. And especially like when I went out for that spacewalk, every time, because for a mission specialist like myself, that was the key moment for me when I assume it's kind of like a professional athlete, although I don't really know because I'm not a professional athlete, but who steps out onto the court or the field for a championship, knowing that whatever happens in the next few hours is going to define them for the rest of their life. And when they're an old man or woman, they'll be sitting around in their easy chair and either looking back at this moment with great satisfaction or tremendous regret. And it's all going to happen in the next few hours. And that's what was going through my head right before I came out to do a spacewalk. So that's what you're thinking about, not about the debris that might slam into you and fry you to a crisp, or the rocket that might blow up, or anything like that. You're thinking about doing your job. So thank you very much. I really appreciate all those great questions. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Garrett.
My pleasure.
Yeah. Yeah, please, a round of applause for Dr. Reisman.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. Oh.
Wow.
Thank you very much.
Well, I think you'll all agree it was well worth having our agenda disrupted this morning. That's just fantastic. We'd have to do it again sometime. But this concludes our morning opening general session. May the CoreNet Global Force be with you through the rest of the summit. Have a great time. Thank you.